Welcome, everyone. Good afternoon. Welcome to another exciting Talks at Google event. This is the second in our ongoing series of speakers from that work with Stanford's Center for the Advanced Study in the Behavioral Sciences. And so today we're very thrilled to host Eric Klinenberg. He's back to the Talks at Google program, having spoken in New York a few years back as well. And without any further ado, please join me in welcoming Eric to Google. Thanks.
Thank you, Cliff. Thank you all for being here during lunch. The food is really good. If you haven't had it yet, you probably know it better than I do, but it's great to be here. Can you hear me okay? Is this fine? So typically these days when I go to give a talk and bring up modern romance, everyone wants to know in advance, is Aziz coming? And you know, look, when you write a book with someone like Aziz, you learn to play the second fiddle, so I'm fine with that. And the answer is usually, you know, I don't know, he could show up. So if anybody comes through this door in the next few minutes, just let's all look and see if it turns out to be Aziz. It would be a little bit of a stretch for him because he's hosting Saturday Night Live this weekend. You might have heard that. It's the day after the inauguration, so it's a high-pressure gig. Nope, it's not Aziz. Well, next time someone comes in, we'll all look, and we'll see if it's Aziz. It might be Aziz. Okay, what I want to do today is actually not talk exclusively about modern romance, as interesting as that is. I want to talk a little bit more generally about the sociology of connection, some patterns that are worth sharing, and I want to do it by talking to you both about this book I wrote a few years ago called Going Solo, about the rise of people living alone in the world, and also then about the research that went into modern romance. And you'll see a common thread emerge through them. And the way I want to get into this is by telling you about a magazine story that came out a few years ago from The Atlantic, which is a really serious and wonderful publication, always very provocative. Definitely not a fake news publication, a real news publication, that tends to go very deep. And they put this story on the cover a few years ago, and I don't know if you can read it clearly, but the cover story is Facebook making us lonely? And that's a question, but as you probably can tell already, it's also an accusation, right? Of course, the answer to the cover story is not no, otherwise it wouldn't be on the cover. Right, and even if it was no, the deed is already done because you've associated Facebook with loneliness in your mind. And if I say don't think of an elephant, I've undermined myself in that very same way. So you here at Google need to know that the story about whether Facebook is making us lonely is not just a story about Facebook. Google is also part of this story because the broader question that this article is taking up, and it's a question that many people in the world these days are raising, is this new culture that we are creating, and that you are creating as much, if not more than anyone, where we spend all this time with our screens on amazing apps and programs and other features that entertain us and help us be productive and connect us in all kinds of interesting ways to people we'd never otherwise be connected to? Are all those things at the end of the day making us more lonely and more isolated than ever before? I'm sure all of you in this room have heard a version of this question, right? I mean, it's a big problem that we're trying to solve. And the author of this piece in The Atlantic, which is a place that everybody who's got ideas and rights wants to be, says, yes, the claim in this article is that we have never been lonelier. Okay, we are now, ironically, we're living through the loneliest age in history. And, okay, so that's a deep and serious journalistic publication. In my own field, we've had similar kinds of debates, and I'm going to talk to you about this study that was in the American Sociological Review on social isolation in American life. Now, I know that you're all regular readers of the American Sociological Review, but occasionally, you know, you forget to put it that like little card in the mail and your subscription lapses. So I'm just going to review for you the findings of that study, if you don't mind. And the study on social isolation made this incredible claim. The article came out in 2006, and it was by a team of sociologists based at Duke. And the blockbuster finding is the one that's on the screen there. It said that they did a survey. It was based on a big social survey. And they looked at the proportion of American adults who said they have no confidant, no close friends. And it went from about 1 in 10 in 1985, which was fairly consistent with the long literature of studies of, on social connections, to 1 in 4 in 2004. Now, obviously, you know, Facebook wasn't really a thing, or much of a thing, in 2004. I don't think it was a thing at all. But so it's not Facebook that's driving the story there. But the idea is that the big thing that changed in our social world in that time period is the internet. And so the claim was, you know, we're now more isolated than we've ever been, and there are all these people who are disappearing, and the internet must be the cause of that. And when this article came out, it was, you know, this is an image from USA Today. The authors were on the Today Show and CNN, and every publication in the world did a feature on them, because that's an incredible finding, right? 1 in 4 Americans have no confidant. And even that claim doesn't come out of nowhere. There's a long history in the social sciences of looking at the fraying social ties of modern life, right? A longstanding claim that we have built these big cities, we've built kind of all kinds of modern conveniences in a mass society, and out of that has come a level of isolation and disconnection that we've never before established. So these are among the best-selling books in the history of sociology and the social sciences. Here on the other side of the political spectrum, the American Spectator, a right-wing publication on the loneliness of American society, citing very similar ideas. More recently, probably some of you have seen books like Bowling Alone from Robert Putnam. Sherry Turkle, I presume, has been here to Google or to the New York Google to talk about her research on people being alone together. More recently, she's got a book about the end of conversation. So this is a very big idea, right? And a couple years ago, when I set out to write a book about this social trend, I thought I would be contributing to that conversation. So when I sold the book for this research project, the working title was Alone in America, okay, which fits really nicely into this tradition, right? And so clearly was about to become a bestseller. All you need is the right title. And as I started to do research, I learned a bunch of amazing things that really changed the way I think about this issue, and these things continue to give me pause when I think about these issues today, and I want to walk you through some of them, right? So imagine if you were going to write a book called Alone in America, it would have a really different mood, a really different cover image than a Going Solo book, right? Going Solo, you can see, is a really different idea. So how did I get there? Well, this was the thing that made me want to write this book in the first place. I noticed what for social scientists is a staggering social change, right? So if any of you have ever been to a meeting of sociologists or demographers, when we discover something like a percentage point or two that's changed in a population trend, we're high-fiving in the hallways, you know, we're like spiking the clicker at the end of our talk. You know, that's a huge accomplishment to make in the social sciences. And, you know, strangely, has not been a lot of discussion about this staggering change that from 1950 to 2014, the proportion of American adults who are single or unmarried goes from 22 to now about 50%. Right? A slight majority of American adults are single today for the first time in recorded history. And the proportion of households that have just one person has gone from 9% in 1950 to a little under 30% today. And these are major, major demographic changes in how we live. And I thought this should be exhibit A in the story of how Americans have become disconnected and lonely and isolated. And in fact, if you read a lot of research papers from other social scientists and surely lots of journalism, it is trotted out as exhibit A for why we're so lonely. There are other ways to represent this trend here. You can just see the kind of steady rise of Americans who are living alone over time. You know, this is a kind of demographic cut of who's living alone. It's interesting, when I started this project, I had just written a book about a big heat wave disaster in Chicago where hundreds of people died and died alone. And I thought the story of living alone in the U.S. was really primarily a story of aging alone. But it turns out that the largest group of Americans who live alone are adults between the ages of 35 and 64. And in recent decades, the biggest spike in living alone has come from this younger generation under the age of 35, right? Like, you get married later, and you start a family much later. So the way that you become an adult for a rising generation is to get a place of your own, right? To get the hell out of your parents' basement and get a place of your own. So even this chart was really interesting to me. It seemed like a more interesting story. And I also learned when I was doing the research that whereas up until about 1950, living alone was something that was most common in big sprawling Western states, Nevada and Wyoming and Montana, by 2000, living alone had become a very urban phenomenon. It was most common in major metropolitan areas. And in Manhattan, where I live, it's almost 1 in 2 households is a one-person household. And San Francisco is like 40%. You think, oh, okay, San Francisco, New York, those are weird places. They're not quite like America. But look at this. Minneapolis, 43%. Denver, 40%. Seattle, 42%. Atlanta, 45%. I mean, it really is far more pervasive, the one-person household, than I had understood. And it was actually far more pervasive than most social scientists had really understood before I did this. So this rise of a single society is a major force in the world. So remember, I talked about this in terms of being alone in America at first, because my premise was that these were people who were not just living alone, but also alone much of the time, and more isolated, more lonely. I'm going to tell you about the alone part in a second, but I want to start by telling you, when you're a social scientist and not a politician or an ideological column writer, one of the great things is you get to be wrong. And you get to be wrong and then say, oh, I totally screwed that up, and I learned something. And here at the end of the day, I have a different idea about how the world works than when I started. That's what's great about social research. So let's start by what a bad idea it was for me to talk about this as alone in America. Living alone is not at all an American trend. In fact, the United States is a laggard and not a leader when it comes to being single. We are way down on this list of places that have a lot of living alone. I don't know if you can read it. It looks very, very small to me. But the Scandinavian countries are at the very top of the list. A bunch of European countries are above us. Living alone is more common in Japan than it is in the United States, which is interesting given the kind of family-centric nature of that culture. Living alone is more prominent in Canada. And I don't know why, but it just kind of irks me in general where Canada ranks ahead of the United States in anything. So that's always been an annoying finding for me. But say it again. There you go. There you go. Flip it around. Genius. We're going to need more thinking like that in the next 4 years, I think. So what about this alone business? Are we really alone? Okay, yes, more people are likely to live alone. But I started doing some research on my own and discovered some extraordinary things. So for instance, it turns out that people who live alone are actually more likely to spend time with friends and neighbors than people who are married. They're more likely to go out at night and spend time in bars or in restaurants and cafes, book talks. They're more likely to go to book talks. They are also more likely, and this was a real surprise to me, to volunteer in civic organizations. So that idea of the selfish single, the narcissist, is not right. Here's a shocker for you. It turns out that women who are single and live alone are far more likely to participate, significantly more likely to participate in civic organizations than women who are married with children. Tough sociology. Someone told me that there's research showing that women who are married tend to do more of the housework than their spouses. They do more cleaning and more taking care of the children and things like that. I had exactly the same reaction you did. That can't be true. There's no way that's right. But apparently it is. And so women who are single actually have more time to engage in the world. And it's not to say that raising children is not a civic duty. It is, of course. But it's an interesting and surprising finding, this level of civic participation. But also, if you look historically at patterns of informal social participation, you find a story that's very different than the, is Facebook making us lonely? We've never been so lonely. We've never been so isolated. These patterns, which show kind of overall trends in spending time with relatives or with friends or with neighbors or in bars, show that basically things haven't changed all that much. Over time, we've had a modest decrease in the amount of time that we spend with neighbors, but we've also had an uptick in the amount of time that we spend with friends who aren't from our neighborhood, which is consistent with our understanding of the way we form social ties right now. Overall, patterns of social participation are just about the same as they were before for informal socializing. And the percentage of people who are really never socializing is also pretty stable. So remember that research study I told you about, the isolation in America? Well, it turns out that the data that study drew upon were flawed and inaccurate. And now one of the authors of this paper, the graduate student who did the real data crunching on this, has backed off from the claim and says it's not reliable. It turns out, though, that this is what my friends and I call the great zombie finding of the social sciences. Like, no matter how often we all kill the thing and say it's not right, you can't kill this study. You can't, like, every time there's an article about loneliness or social isolation, a trend in American life, you will get in the first few paragraphs a citation to this study, and serious scholars do it all the time. Journalists do it. It's a huge problem. But you can understand why that headline is so memorable. Imagine if, when we put up findings like the one you just saw, the USA Today had a headline that said, "Americans, just about as lonely and isolated as we've always been." That would be a completely boring headline that no one would ever read or pay attention to. It turns out that our social life is much more interesting, but also more stable than people generally acknowledge. So I don't think that we can evince this claim right now. We can't show that there's been a real spike in loneliness. In fact, the main claim, even empirically, in the Atlantic story about loneliness comes from a study that the AARP did of older people who were, in fact, not even using Facebook at the time. So the data are really poor for this claim. And that's not to say that there's not potential for us to become more lonely or more isolated, given the way that we use technologies, but it hasn't happened yet. We should need to be a lot more somber about this. So I had written this book about the rise of single people in the world, and I did it with the Penguin Press. And a few weeks late, I guess months after the thing came out, I got this call out of nowhere saying, "Eric, it's your editor. Sorry to bother you. I've got this kind of funny question. Have you ever heard of a guy named Aziz Ansari?" And this is, 2013, so he wasn't quite the household name. But he wasn't expecting my response, which was, "Aziz Ansari, he's my hero." Because it turns out, I had become a big Aziz Ansari fan. He said, "Oh, that's great news, because we really would love to have you guys work together on a project." And I said, "Well, what's the project about?" And he said, "Oh, well, let me explain. Why don't you just come down here? Aziz is sitting in my office, and he wants to talk to you about it." So I dropped my things and raced over there to go talk. And here's Aziz's account of the thing the problem that he was trying to work through at the time.
You have a special out now that everyone's talking about, and Aziz Ansari, Buried Alive. I understand you're already working on your next special. Is that true?
Yeah, I've already written the next hour. I'm going to start touring it next year. And this one's about this new one that I'm working on is about kind of what it means to be single in this era. I think it's really a frustrating time to be a single person right now. I like the idea of being single in theory. That's like, you meet a bunch of different people, you get to know them. When you meet someone you really like, you kind of pursue a deeper thing. That sounds cool. I would sign up for that. But that's not what being single is anymore now. Like, this is what being single is now. Like, "Hey, it was great meeting you. We should get together sometime." "Yeah, that'd be great. Be in touch. All right, cool. Bye." "Hey, what's up? Should we grab a drink tonight?" "Yeah, yeah. I'm with some friends in this neighborhood." "Oh, cool. We'll be down there soon. Can't wait to see you. All right, cool. Bye." "Hey, what's up? We're almost there." "Shit, we just left." "Why? Why did you just leave?" "That's so rude. You knew I was on the way."
Uh-huh.
"Maybe we can get a drink tomorrow." "Tomorrow's perfect. Text us now and make a plan." "All right, cool. Bye." "Hey, what's up? Should we grab those drinks tonight?" "Oh, drank way too much last night. Gonna stay in today." "That's not what was discussed yesterday. You need a transcript of our conversation? Scroll up on your phone." "Maybe we can meet up on Tuesday." "Tuesday's perfect. Text it down and make a plan." "All right, cool. Bye." "Hey, what's up? It's Tuesday. Should we get together today?" And that's what being single is now. All that garbage. That's what it's become. It's pretty much now a lot of times like you're a secretary for this really shoddy organization scheduling the dumbest shit with the flakiest people ever.
I'm sorry I'm missing out on all that.
All right, so that was the problem that Aziz was struggling with when I first met him. You know, okay, so there are all these people who are single today, and Aziz is one of them. And the culture's really become confusing. Once upon a time, maybe it was easier to find romance. Maybe it was a simpler process. Now it seems really convoluted. And Aziz wanted to know, what do we actually know about how the search for romance has changed over time? What are some of the dilemmas that people face today? And he said, I've been looking for research. He actually reads a lot of social science. And I just couldn't find anything. So I just said, screw it. I'm going to do it myself. Maybe I won't do it myself. Maybe I'll find a social scientist to do it with me. And so we decided to do it. And it was a very interesting collaboration. We had no idea what it was going to be like. It was a terrifying thing for me because I take my time pretty seriously, like most scholars, and kind of cherish the ability I have to do research. And on the one hand, this is a tremendously exciting opportunity to work with someone who I think is really a genius and entertaining and insightful in ways that the great comedians are. But on the other time, on the other hand, it was a little bit of a wild ride to take. But you only live once, and how could I say no? And that was the question, which one of these combinations was it going to be? So there's a bunch of things that we tried to do to get ourselves oriented to the questions for the book. One of them was just trying to figure out what the search for romance is aiming towards these days. And it's pretty clear that if you look at our search for romance historically, our expectations of what we want have changed quite a bit, even over the last several decades. The way that we really established this, or that I was able to establish this for Aziz, is I said, look, most of the people you hang out with are in their 20s or early 30s, and you have this particular kind of world that you inhabit. We're here in Manhattan right now. Let's walk down a few blocks from the Village to the Lower East Side, and let's go to an old folks' home. Let's go to a senior center and gather a bunch of people together for a conversation and have them tell us about how they met their spouse. And Aziz was like, oh, that sounds like a really good idea, but why on earth would anyone ever come and talk to us? They're not going to know who we are. They've got other stuff to do. And I was like, no problem. We can solve this. Donuts. So we went and got boxes of donuts, and we showed up at the senior center, and everybody came for the conversation. And it was a great conversation, a great way to recruit a sample. And we started asking people to tell us a story about how they met their spouse. And one after the next, people would say, oh, well, I was 23 years old, and I was living with my parents, and my older brother had this friend, and I knew that guy. He'd spent a lot of time around the family when I was a kid, and we went out one day, and he seemed like a pretty good guy, so we got married. And it was like, oh, wow, that's a crazy story. And then went next one, there was someone who lived in my building, and I know their family forever, and I was 19 years old, and I was living at home. And we went out for a few times, and we got married. And we were trying to figure out, well, this is an amazing thing. What's this about? That seems really odd. And people started explaining, well, actually, the thing was that back then, it wasn't really legitimate for you to move out of your parents' house, especially if you were a woman, if you weren't married, and you really wanted to escape your parental control, and this was a great way to do it. Premarital sex was really frowned upon. There's just no place to go. And so getting married was something that you did very early in your life, and it was also something that you did very local. And so we heard these conversations. I said, that rings a bell. I remember these studies that I heard about in graduate school. Let me go back and see. And it turns out that in the 1930s and 40s, there was an industry in American sociology of doing propinquity studies. And sociologists would look at things like the marriage records of 5,000 consecutive marriages in the city of Philadelphia and see, who was marrying whom, just because you had to put your address for both the husband and the wife and the wedding certificate. So this is one classic study from a guy named James Broussard. It came out, I think, in 1933. And it's extraordinary. It shows that this, unfortunately, you can't see, but it's around 12% of marriages in the city of Philadelphia. This is just 5,000 straight marriage records were people who lived in the same building, okay? Not related. About 4.5% were on the same block, and 6% were within two blocks. So it's almost one in four marriages in Philadelphia in 1932 were between two people who lived within two blocks of one another. you know? And Aziz is like, I wouldn't even want to go for coffee with one of those bozos who live within two blocks of me, like, let alone get married. And so something like 80% of all marriages took place to people who lived within 20 blocks of one another in Philadelphia. And the typical age of first marriage around that time was something like 21 or 22 for women and 23 for men, right? Now, people were looking for what the sociologist Andrew Cherlin calls the good enough spouse. They wanted a good enough marriage, like someone who it was like they were not an axe murderer. It was basically their number one characteristic. And the number two was like they knew somebody in the family and you probably grew up around them, right? So now, in 2010, 5% of people in 2010 married somebody who was a neighbor. 22% met someone who they met online, married someone they met online. Already today, meeting online is the most common way that Americans meet their spouses. People still met in bars and got married. By the way, if you're single, that's a terrible place to meet someone to get married. Don't marry someone you met in a club, please. That's a really bad idea. Friends of friends, also very common. But you could see just how much the world has changed from 1930 to 2010. I mean, it's extraordinary what this transformation is. And by the way, that's for straight couples. For same-sex couples, the use of the internet is off the charts, right? I mean, and that was a kind of a very difficult situation. If you grew up in a community where there weren't a lot of people interested in same-sex relationships, it was very hard to find someone. The internet has completely changed the game there, right? And what's happening now is, you know, we're starting to see these trends move into other areas, including like second marriages, older people who are looking for kind of a second marriage or third marriage after a divorce, or they've become widows or widowers. The internet is really growing as a way to meet people. But when people look to get married, they're not just looking for a good enough spouse anymore. Generally, people in interviews will tell you they're looking for a soulmate. Right? They're looking for someone who completes them, with whom they feel like this kind of deep, deep soulful connection that they wouldn't otherwise have in life, right? And so not only do we think it's okay to look for a soulmate, that's what we should do, we're willing to spend a very long time in that search, right? So today, we marry later than ever. Historically, the average age of first marriage is 26 or 27 for women and 28 or 29 for men. In urban communities like this one, the average age of first marriage is over 30, right? If you work at Google and you've got like a 26-year-old colleague who's getting married, 50 years ago, it would be like, that's amazing, I can't believe it took you so long, but congratulations, it's great news, I hope you can still get pregnant. And now, if you have a 26-year-old who's getting married, you're like, are you crazy? What are you doing? You know, you have to live a little bit, you know? You don't even know who you're gonna be yet, right? And actually, it turns out that we know that if you get married before the age of 25, you are far more likely to get divorced than if you get married after. And we have the sense that by kind of growing up as a single person, you're in a better position to have a stable relationship over time. And the data bear that out a little bit. So one big change is that we have a different expectation, right? We're not looking for good enough marriages. We're looking for soulmates. That's a very hard search. It can take a very long time, but the potential payoff can be very high. Another big change is obviously about the way that we do that search, and I showed you some slides that suggested how much the internet has become a part of this. But one of the things that Aziz was convinced of, and that was borne out by the research we did over a couple years, is that being single is very different in a world where most of us live a lot of our lives in these machines, right? Anyone here happen to be carrying a phone with them today? Anybody have a phone with them? You're the only honest person in the room. We're all carrying phones with us. We all carry phones with us wherever we go. If we don't have our phones with us, we feel really weird, like someone has, you know, like taken our oxygen away. And that's changed the way that we live, right? We participate in this face-to-face world occasionally. Like speaking at Google in this series is amazing because they're like, okay, like there's going to be like 30 or 40 people at your talk, but there'll be 3,000 people watching you from their desks. I'll be like, oh, that in New York, that makes a lot of sense. Like, it's too bad they can't be there. But like, no, like in the next room. It's just weird to actually see you face to face. So hi, guys, watching on your screens right now. There's plenty of seats. You guys are all welcome to come and join us. So we spend a lot of our time on our phones. And what that means is that whereas, you know, not long ago, if you wanted to meet somebody, you would go to like a bar or to a party, you know, meet like friends of friends, you'd be set up on a date. You know, and those things happen, by the way, like some people would do that at 9 a.m, but most of us did that like after 8 p.m, you know, like you'd go out and there's like, you know, I remember like when I was in college, Thursday or Friday night, you would walk out and you would all go to like a physical party together and you'd hope that that person who was in your history class who was really cute would show up. And maybe even think like, oh, maybe I know she's going to come to that party. And you didn't have cell phones. So you just hope that she was there in like the same hour block. And if not, you'd spend like the whole night walking around campus hoping you'd bump into each other. Right? And now it's like you would never do that because you would just text the person and find out if they were there. But more importantly, for people who aren't on college campuses, you're basically carrying a singles bar in your pocket all the time. Right? So if you're here and you have a phone and you're single, and I'm sure there's at least one of you like that here, chances are, you know, you've got Tinder in your phone, right? You've got Bumble in your phone. You've got OkCupid in your phone. If you're really serious about this, you've got Match in your phone. You're like, I'm going to do it this year, 2017. I'm going to go for Match.com. I'm going to make a commitment. And that really changes the dynamics. It means that like at any given moment, you have access to thousands of potential partners, and you could be flirting with them, you could be just kind of playing around. Like we were doing the research, Tinder had just come out, and nobody wanted to admit that they were actually trying to meet people on Tinder. They're like, oh, I just did it with my friends, kind of for a laugh. It was just really, we all thought it was funny. But meanwhile, everybody was starting to date on Tinder. And this is really challenging. Like, it's hard to do the thing you're supposed to be doing at any given time because you are living with a singles bar in your pocket, right? That's a very tough situation. What that also means is you're looking for your soulmate. You've got thousands of options. And people every day are presented with what Barry Schwartz, the psychologist, talks about as the paradox of choice, right? You know, you've got all these possibilities. And it turns out it's really, really difficult to live with enormous numbers of options. There are maximizers in the world who are always looking for the best thing. And if we're looking for love, we're probably maximizers most of the time. And then there's satisficers who are just like looking for the good enough marriage, but there are not a lot of those satisficers. And the problem is now if you are looking for the best relationship and you have Tinder, the comparisons can never stop, right? And so what's so difficult about choice, Schwartz told us, is, you know, first of all, when you have a lot of options, it's difficult to know what it is that you really care about. You know, what should really matter to you, and how do you make a selection for a particular person? But then also, let's say I've gone through like 150 people on Tinder, and I've swiped right, and she swiped right too, and we make the connection, and then we go and meet each other. Within 5 minutes, I'm like, oh, is that really the right person? Because there are 999 other people who are there, you know, tonight. And I should run to the bathroom and like swipe right again and see. So there's a problem with people not feeling good about the choices they made because they have regret about the people they've overlooked. And that's an enormous challenge for people who are dating today. Then there are all kinds of interactional dilemmas that happen when people are trying to find romance through machines. Anybody here ever had this conversation with a friend? Like, you meet somebody online, or your friend meets someone online. Let's just talk about it in terms of friends. And they're like, oh, I like them. I want to ask them out, but I don't know what the right message is. And the person's like, oh, it doesn't matter what you write. Like, if they like your picture, they're going to like you. If they like your picture, they're going to like you. It doesn't matter what you text. You know, don't even worry about the messaging. Have anyone heard a version of that story? Yes?
Yes?
Yes? Okay. Thank you. Google is still alive. Okay. So Aziz and I wanted to get like the definitive scientific answer to this question of does it actually matter what you text someone, or is it really just about the pictures? Like, we know the pictures are really important. So we realized that every night when Aziz was doing stand-up, he was talking to thousands of people. And it was a great way to have conversations about people's experiences in the world. We could kind of use them as like massive social experiments and interviews and focus groups. So I want to read you a quick passage from the book. And if you can, just like try to imagine me reading this in Aziz's voice. It would be much funnier. Okay. So he says, at this particular show, I was speaking with Rachel, who had met a guy at a good friend's wedding. As it happened, the guy was also a friend of her sister's, so he had a pretty good shot at a first date with her. She was single, she was interested. All he had to do was send her a simple message introducing himself and asking her to do something. Here's what happened. He sends his first message. Hi, Rachel! Exclamation point. Since I never got a chance to ask you to dance at Marissa and Chris's wedding, parentheses, I'm Chris's old roommate from Purdue, dot, 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 and parentheses. He and your sister gave me your number. I wanted to say hi and sort of texty introduce myself. Ha ha, smiley face. Hope you had a great weekend. Hope to chat with you soon. As soon as I said texty, it was clear that no one sitting in the 3,600-seat Chicago theater would ever fuck this dude in a million years. Texty, for whatever reason, seemed to be unequivocally disgusting to every one of us there. He might as well have added, by the way, I have a really disgusting next-level STD. Ha ha ha. Smiley face. But for real, I do. Rachel wrote back 10 minutes later. By the way, I recognize this is probably the end of the CASBIS Google seminar series here. So it is what it is. It was good while it lasted. Hey, exclamation point. Great to meet you, too. Currently enjoying my birthday weekend with lots of good Mexican food. Parentheses, it happens when your birthday is Cinco de Mayo. Hope you had a great weekend, too. He wrote back shortly. There's like eight O's here. I totally realized upon reading my last message, I didn't include my name. Ha ha ha. I'm Will, smiley face. Feliz cumpleaños as well. And totally digging on that Cinco de Mayo theme. Rachel never met Will. After a few messages of this nature, Rachel stopped responding. None of us know Will. He may be a kind, handsome man with a heart of gold, but all we have to go on is those messages. And those messages have shaped in our minds a very dorky, terrifyingly Caucasian weirdo. Yes, it matters what you text. Now, it matters what you text, but it's hard still to know what is appropriate to text and what isn't, because our norms about what you can communicate via text message are changing very rapidly. And things that seem really strange to us today, you know, might soon be very normal. And in fact, like, even as we did interviews for the book with people of different generations, we heard really funny things. Like, you know, when we started, we asked these questions like, let's say I have this, is it okay to break up with somebody by text? You know, can you break up with someone by text? And we talked to people who were in their late 20s and be like, oh, no way. You know, that is, I know I'm not 30 yet, but still, that is a horrible thing to do to a person. You know, like, breaking up is really painful, and you know, you owe it to that person to be there face to face and just to say what you think and to have that physical interaction with someone. Like, I would never do that. And we talk to people who are like in their late or early 20s, and they'd say, you know, I know that you shouldn't break up with somebody by text. I mean, it's a shitty thing to do, but honestly, like, yes, I do. We do everything by text, so I figure it's. We might as well. Like, I asked her out by text the first time. It's fine. So yes, I do it. I don't feel good about it. I know it's not right, but I do it. And then we talk to like people in their late teens, you know, like freshmen in college, and they're like, oh my God, Aziz, Eric, I wish someone would break up with me by text. Like, all I want in life is someone to break up with me by text. Like, there's this guy I was seeing for months, and I haven't heard from him in forever, and I think we're not going out anymore, but I don't really know because he doesn't respond. So if you just write me a text message and say it's over, it would be amazing. So we're even seeing this like change from like these small kind of parts inside generations over time. Right, threading through all this is this question of, you know, return back to this Facebook issue of does Facebook make us lonely? It doesn't make us lonely, but now that we do spend so much of our time interacting with people digitally, and now that our social worlds have expanded so that we interact with people who we don't know all that well personally, maybe we have text-based relationships, or they're part of a social circle, they're friends of friends of friends, but they're still there, does it make it easier for us to treat them as bubbles on a screen, right, and not as people? And I don't think we've settled this question, but I think it really is an interesting question. You know, what is the evolving nature of social norms in a world where we're communicating with different kinds of people who are, you know, part of our network in some way, but not, you know, core intimate partners? Okay, let me wrap up. I always feel like I should provide some public service at the end of these talks. So, you know, people often want to know, like, okay, you did all that research. It's very interesting. Appreciate that time when you read from the book and got Aziz's voice in there, because I actually got a genuine laugh in that moment. But is there anything that you learned in the course of this project that can actually help me as a single person or my cousin? And so I've got three things I'd like to close with today, three short pieces of advice. If you're interested, anyone, would that be helpful just to give three kind of like dating tips from all this? In case you're okay, so we got three dating tips. I'm happy to come back on Valentine's Day in a few weeks. Okay, number one, first dating tip comes from, comes from Rob Willer, who's a sociologist and social psychologist at Stanford. If he hasn't come here, Cliff, to give a talk, you should get him over here. He's a great, great guy, amazing speaker. And Rob was helping us with some of the analysis. He does these terrific social experiments. But then actually what Rob wound up helping us with the most came from his own life. And he's like, oh, well, one of the problems with dating these days is like you don't want to go on these really boring ass first dates. Everybody online does like they do these boring ass first dates. And the reason is that, can you raise your hand if you've ever gone on an online date in this room? Do you mind? I know we're at a workplace, so it's a little bit awkward. Okay, so if you've ever gone on a first date with someone you met online, you know, the problem is you don't want to overinvest in the first date, right? Because it's a stranger, and we know that they're like 5 years older and 25 pounds heavier than they look in their photograph, right? And so nobody really wants to overinvest. It's not like, oh, a first date, you know, we're going to Manresa, and then I rented a sailboat, and we're going to do a cruise. Like, you never do that, but you also don't want to like go to Starbucks and have a latte, because everything we know about research, you know, on dating says like our experience with another person is contextual, right? And so the environment really matters. And if like you're sitting in a Starbucks having a latte, it's going to be a really boring first date. You're going to do a resume exchange, and you're like, I don't know, she wasn't that interesting. There's no spark there. So Rob said, oh, the first thing that people do wrong and what you should try to do if you're dating is you need to follow the monster truck rally theory of first dates. And that is every first date should be in some place that's like super interesting and kind of quirky and is going to make you laugh kind of no matter what you're doing. And it should be kind of surprising and kind of fun. Monster truck rallies he likes, because especially for like the overeducated tech, you know, Silicon Valley people, you know, you probably don't spend a lot of time at monster truck rallies. But if someone said like, hey, let's go to a monster truck rally, you'd be like, whoa, that seems like a really interesting and fun idea. We're going to do it. And it's like the quality of the whole interaction and the quality of the evening is going to be really great. And so you don't have to go to a monster truck rally, but the idea is like for your first date, do something that's like you've always really wanted to do on your own, but you just don't have enough time, and use the date as an excuse to go do that fun thing with another person. Make sense? Okay, that's tip number one. Okay, now this one, you probably studied this in your social science classes in college or graduate school. You're probably familiar with the flow rider theory of acquired likability through repetition. You remember that one? No? Okay, fine. At the end of this talk, I want you to resubscribe to the American Sociological Review and review your psychology notes from college. Okay, the flow rider theory of acquired likability through repetition is basically tells us that in the end, people are pretty much like flow rider songs, which is you hear them the first time, and you're like, I don't know. I've heard that song. I don't know. This flow rider is the same song. It's not that interesting. I don't need another one of these. But then, if you keep listening to the Flo Rida song again and again, you're like, oh my God, Flo Rida, you are amazing. I love that song. It turns out we have very similar responses to people, that if you have like a second date, a third date, the things that are specific and interesting and distinctive about people are not actually what they look like. They're things that come out in interactions over time. And the big mistake that daters generally make is they tend to overvalue superficial things on the first date, like hotness. and undervalue things that, right? Because we all know that that kind of the temperature of the hotness is going to decrease no matter what, right? No matter who it is that you're dating, right? I mean, probably everyone in this room once like dated someone who they thought was way more attractive than them. They're like, I can't believe I'm actually dating her. And then like on the third day, like, oh my God, I have nothing to say to this person. Right? So we tend to overvalue hotness, and we tend to undervalue the things that actually really matter to us over time and in relationships. And those are things that tend to come out over repeated exposure in interactions. Right? Which is not to say like attraction doesn't matter. Of course attraction matters. There's a baseline that you have to hit. But there are a lot of people who are like, I don't know, she seemed pretty cool. Yeah, I guess she's pretty attractive. There just wasn't that spark on the first time. You're like, what'd you do? Oh, we're at a bowling alley. Oh, bowling, that sounds so fun. Oh no, we're in the lounge having a Coke. You know, you're never going to fall in love with someone in a bowling alley lounge on a first date over a Coke. You know, this is a bad way to fall in love. So give someone a chance. That's the second one. And then the third one, this might be the most practical thing I'm going to leave you with. So there's another kind of dilemma and problem that, you know, people have in a world where a lot of our relationships are online. And that is like, okay, you start dating somebody, you're with them for a while, you build up this relationship, you have all these friends in common. You not only share experiences together, you now share a phone world and a digital life together. Like you're posting pictures of her and him. They're all over, you're all over Instagram and Facebook, that your lives are totally intertwined. And then you break up and now you've got this problem, which is that like you can't get rid of this person from your history. And you want to go back and like look at the picture, vacation pictures or pictures of yourself at parties, see like the friends, the other experiences you had. But every time you do it, you have a photograph of your ex with you. And so Aziz and I found a great strategy for dealing with this. It's just called Beyoncify Your Ex. And what that means is it doesn't have to be Beyonce, by the way. You could do this with Sonia Sotomayor. you could do it with, you could choose Rick Perry. There's any number of people you could do. Basically, you want to pick a fairly well-known person and just get an image of their face and just paste it over the image of your ex all over the internet, and that will solve all of your problems. So thank you very much. I really enjoyed the conversation. I hope that was useful.
Hi. So yeah, I was really enlightened to hear about how your findings disproved like that really popular study that you said is unfounded, that people are actually lonelier now than before.
Oh, the study that showed that people were lonely.
Yeah. And it kind of like brought to my mind this quote that got circulated shortly after the death of Robin Williams, which I think I'm going to misquote it, but it's this phenomenon of the worst thing isn't to be alone, but is to be around people who make you feel alone. So I guess from your studies, how do you feel that like technology has contributed to that feeling, and like what do you actually call that?
Yeah.
So
that's a really interesting question. So there is this issue that's a little bit related to the problem of choice that I brought up before. And that is that many people today find it very difficult to be where they are. So think about the last hour that we've spent together, you know? Now, it's very hard for most people to spend an hour without checking their phone to see what's happened. Did any of you check your phone in the last hour? Come on. This is the greatest hour of my life. I mean, everybody checks their phone all the time. And, you know, I don't take it personally that you checked your phone in the last hour. We are hooked on these things. We're looking for this new stimulation, right? We're wondering what's going on in our personal life, in our home life. Who won the soccer game? There's all sorts of information that we could be getting at any time, which is actually generally not all that urgent. But we're somehow in this cultural moment where not everyone, but a lot of us are kind of hungry for the next new burst of information. Like we want that adrenaline rush, that endorphin kick that we're going to get from getting the new thing. And so we're constantly failing to appreciate the place we're in and the people we're with. And what I oftentimes think now is like, unless you're sitting directly across to or next to a person you have met in the last 3 weeks and are currently in the process of falling deeply in love with, there's almost no thing that you're going to be doing that's going to completely distract you from like the buzzing noises your phone is making in your pocket, right? It's very hard for people to focus on where they are. And so what happens is it becomes very easy to degrade the quality of everyday interactions and to take your relationships for granted. And I do worry about that. So that's not exactly kind of the loneliness of being alone. It's a different kind of experience. Now, interestingly, that doesn't show up on surveys of how lonely people are. The best measures we have of for loneliness don't tap into that. But I do think that that's a phenomenon that's worth paying attention to. And I'll tell you something from the Going Solo project that was very powerful to me. So many people I interviewed who had lived with someone and who then got separated and became single, lived on their own, said, my friends are always worried about me. They ask me if I'm lonely. And what I tell them is, yes, there are moments of real pain when I'm home by myself, single, and thinking about what my future is going to be like. But I'll tell you the truth. There's nothing lonelier than a bad relationship. There's nothing lonelier than living with the wrong person. I think it's very true. Okay.
Eric, thanks so much for coming. So you brought up the topic of now we're more searching for our soulmate rather than just a spouse that's good enough. And I've noticed that even now that we're some people even find that soulmate's not good enough. They want something more than soulmate.
Well, what's that?
Twin flame.
What?
Twin flame.
Oh, that's so weird.
It's a new thing.
Yeah.
Right? It's like soulmate plus plus. Are there actually any research saying that finding your soulmate actually makes you happier? Because I'm very skeptical about...
No, there's no research like that at all, actually. No, I mean, there really isn't. So it's not as if, what I'm reporting to you is that, in fact, people find their soulmates, and we know that if you find your soulmate and match on all the key criteria of, like, what constitutes a soul, then you'll be happy. I mean, we don't have that, right? So people are optimizing for a random set of things. And one thing we do know is that we're terrible at knowing what it is that we want in another person. And the reason we know this is because of all the great data that we get from dating sites where people, you go on match.com and you say, here are the five things I'm looking for. I want a blonde woman who has a PhD from an Ivy League school in the natural sciences, not the social sciences, right? And she has to like skiing and be pro-choice. And then turn out that if you look at what that person is actually choosing, who is that person asking out, right? They're like tall brunettes who grew up in the South and have a high school degree, right? And like volleyball and vote for Republicans. And it turns out that we're just really shitty at knowing what it is that makes us happy. And so the kind of research that you're asking for of how are we actually matching is really hard to come by. That said, and I should say one other thing. There's actually really interesting research on arranged marriages because Aziz's parents had an arranged marriage. And we talked about this a lot, we did interviews with them when we looked into the research on arranged marriages. At some point, we were sitting together doing research and I started cracking up because Aziz had just told me how his father met his wife and married his wife or found his wife. And the story was his parents decided it was time for him to get married. They introduced him to one woman, and she was too tall, and then they introduced him to the woman who became his wife, and that was the right decision. And it occurred to me that actually, Aziz spends more time trying to figure out where to get a taco than his father spent figuring out which was the right woman to marry. If you ever wanted to eat with Aziz, it's incredibly difficult. He's totally an optimizer, maximizer, and he does enormous amounts of research on everything, because why would you ever want to have the second best taco in the East Village? And that can be really difficult. But his stepfather or his father went through this pretty simple process. And it turns out with unarranged marriages, there's this idea when the marriage begins, there's kind of a simmer, just a little bit of heat. And then over the course of time in successful marriages, you kind of build up to the boil and the intimacy. And actually the record on arranged marriage is pretty strong in terms of longevity and people's feelings about the quality of the marriage compared to our system of marrying the person you want to marry by choice after having searched for your soulmate. So I think there's really, really good reason to be skeptical, of that. But what we do know, I was going to say, that said, is that there does seem to be some value in waiting until later in life to get married. And we do know that there's a lot of volatility in people's, you know, formative years, both in terms of your life, what, you know, where you are, what you're going to do, and in terms of your character development. And so, you know, people who marry younger without having gone through that search are just more likely to have the relationships burn out. So that was a somewhat obnoxious and long-winded answer to your really smart question.
So my question focuses on cohabitation. So the, you know, the fulfillment of happiness when you're living with someone kind of depends on, like, your level of slappiness. Can the other person cook? Do they clean up? You know, like, all those things.
Like, not to be biographical about this, but from what I understand, are you cleaning up after yourself?
Yeah. So my question is, what's the research, or your, if there isn't research, what's your personal opinion on, you know, are couples more successful if they live together or apart? But, you know, people who might have different houses or apartments, but they're married, for example.
Yeah, I don't know this debate as much as I should, probably. I have a memory of reading studies showing that actually there was a relationship between cohabitation and separation down the road, that people were more likely to ultimately divorce if they cohabitated before marriage. But that was just like a simple correlation. And then it turns out if you tease it out, there was something about the composition of the population. Like, people who are more likely to live together first were also more likely to be in the population of people who get divorced. So to be honest, I can't give you like the state of the art finding on that. But there's definitely a lot of research on it. Definitely not. Definitely not writing about that issue. Because it would be weird because so I'm married. I want to be clear about that, which was very difficult for me when I was doing the Going Solo book, because I was like inadvertently became this person who's like, Eric Klinenberg will talk about the joys of singlehood, which is not what I was going for. But I wound up like writing this book about how actually people who live alone, they're very social. They tend to, like, turns out the happiness levels are much higher than we thought. And then so I would get invited to all these like singles, you know, celebrate single. And My poor wife was like, you know, at first I thought this was like your kind of escape fantasy book, and now I'm getting a little bit worried about this this project. And then I started writing a book, you know, about how young people like hook up, basically, and that was suspicious. And so if I'm like, you know, and then my wife and I did cohabitate before we got married, so if I got really like deep into that question, she probably already has a lot of doubts to begin with. So I think it's a bad idea. Yeah, I'm not going to do that.
Maybe Aziz can do it then.
But thanks for the suggestion.
So if you learn a lot more about yourself as you grow up, and you're supposed to wait, you know, till you get older, until you marry, what are you supposed to do in the meantime? Like, I just graduated from college. Should I just like twiddle my thumbs for four years?
By the way, do you know this guy who's sitting next to you? You guys ever met?
No.
He's looking. Yeah, because you're looking at you like, what the fuck are you talking about? What are you supposed to do? He's thinking like, are you serious?
No.
You're single in the Bay Area and you work at Google. What do you mean? What are you supposed to be doing in the next? You guys talk after this. He's gonna tell you where to go.
Should you date people seriously? Like, you know, like the idea of like, should you be in year-long plus relationships, or should you be, you know, trying out more? I don't know. I mean, just kind of curious what the research says.
I'm going to, like, you know what I've decided to do? I'm just going to put, like, I'm going to work in one of these private offices after the talk, and I'm just going to take you, like, one at a time, like, kind of like the haircut truck you guys have on campus. I'll be, like, a relationship advisor, and you can just come. You have to pay for the haircuts here, right? So like the tacos are free, but you got to pay for the haircut. So I'm going to charge for these sessions, but you could come. And I think there's value in being in relationships. And you know, if you meet someone who is, you have a wonderful connection with, and it really gels, and you know it's like the right thing. I'm not trying to say, you know, that's a crazy thing, right? Like, I'm a social scientist, and I'm thinking about large population samples, and I'm thinking probabilistically, right? So in your case of one person, you're going to know what's right for you better than a sociologist who's looking at big populations. I think there's lots of value in being in relationships. There's lots of value in having intimate experiences with someone else. There's no rush to get married. certainly in a rush to get married and have children. You know, once you start to lock in these parts of your life, that things get difficult. And if you wind up changing in ways that were unpredictable, you know, you find that you're constrained. And it's interesting. Like this is really a deep thing about the cultural situation we find ourselves in. Since the late 19th century, there's been a concept in the sociology that I like quite a lot called the cult of the individual. And it refers to the way in modern life that we have come to value what's good for me, what's good for the individual, as opposed to what's good for the collective that I'm a part of, right? And there's kind of a famous line about, you know, why would a family entrust something as important as marriage to the people getting married? The marriage is not about two people. When two people get married, it's a family event. It structures groups of people. Why would you let two young, stupid people make a decision like that, right? So what's happened over time is that our sense that our behavior should be oriented towards optimizing the group experience, right? The group well-being has been replaced by a notion that our behavior should optimize our individual condition, right? It used to be the case that if you were in a bad marriage and you were really unhappy and you wanted to get divorced, not very long ago, you would have to justify to your friends and to your family this decision to get divorced. This was the wrong thing to do. But now, if you're in a bad marriage and you're really unhappy, you'll have to justify to your friends and family why you should stay in it. Because our notion is like, if you as an individual aren't fulfilled and getting what you need, then it is wrong for you to be in that situation. So our values have really shifted on this. And so that, you know, that's when we talk about like, don't put yourself in a binding situation that is going to be difficult for you down the line, depending on who you develop. That's, I just want to call attention to my own response to what you're saying, which is like, that is rooted in a very specific cultural understanding of what constitutes good behavior and a good life. And it is quite remarkable, you know, I've found throughout these projects I've done, the extent to which our sense of what's good ethical behavior is rooted in our commitment to ourselves as individuals, as the prime actors. So that was a great way for me to dodge the substance of your question while saying something, you know, marginally interesting. Okay.
So what you'll be writing about next and who you hope that call is from. So you got to meet Aziz. You didn't know that he was curious about this topic.
No.
If there's anybody else that you'd like to partner with, who would it be?
Oh, wow. So I'm writing now a book about what I call social infrastructure. And those are the places and institutions that shape the way we interact. And actually, plea to Google, one of the things I really want to study is workplaces and how can you design a workplace so that you facilitate interactions and promote, you know, cohesion and connection. And while I'm here in the Bay Area, I'd really like to know more about what Google does. So if anyone here happens to work at Google, or you're connected to anyone who works at Google, and you could help me, I would really appreciate that. I'll give you back all of my speaking fee for today. This lecture, I will refund 100% of my speaker's fee for that information. So I would love to. I actually love to learn more about Google, and I'm writing that book. And who would I be unable to say no to if they called me and asked if I could write a book with them? I haven't even thought about that question. Can I get back to you on that? Sergey and Larry? No, those chumps, what do they know? I don't know. I don't know. That's such a good question. Damn it. I wish I knew the answer to that question.
We can talk about it.
Continue
I'm gonna,
the theme.
I'm going to think about it.
Continue.
I'm taking suggestions. Say it. Who?
Kahneman.
Daniel Kahneman.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. He's got a new book about him already, though. It's probably better than what I could do.
Nick Offerman.
Say it again.
Do Nick Offerman. You'll continue the Parks and Rec tradition.
Actually, I did get a call from Key and Peele's agent right after the book came, and asking if I would come and talk to them. And then I got really scared that I would just become known as that social scientist who writes with comedians. and I didn't do it. So, plus, as you can all tell, like what really happened to me is I developed this like fantasy that I too would someday become a comedian and find a social scientist to write with me. But I think we're a long, long way from that happy day. So, are we done, Cliff?
Yeah,
thank
we are.
You very
perhaps
much,
one day. Thank you very much, Eric.